those, and then we'll see who would like to stand up. We have a couple of students who can actually who can bring a microphone to you. So when you have a question, we'll ask you to identify yourself and pose your question as succinctly as possible. Let's see. Let me give you this mic. Let me borrow your mic for a second. Okay. Thanks. Okay. So we have a series of questions. The first set of questions is about social media, and I think more broadly about technological advances, and maybe also about the politics of meaning. How have the new media driven us apart, and what can be done to correct the situation? What role can or should the internet play, perhaps social media, in creating meaning in order to help keep the democracy healthy? In thinking about participation in modern democracy, participation in identity, what are your thoughts on the role of social media, especially when it comes to the anonymity and mediated selves that are made possible through technology? And on the other hand, the need for community and political friendship in a democracy. More generally, is the rise of social media more an aid or a hindrance to democracy? So, thoughts on social media, new media.
We'll share this mic.
Well, I think it's obvious pluses to social media when you think of that Korean election a couple of times ago, where the election really turned around at the last minute by people communicating through social media. If you think of Tahrir Square, you know, that became possible for people to come together so quickly because of social media. But there's a terrible downside, which has to, I mean, both, I suppose, come positive and negative, come from the same factor, that we don't have to be in the presence of each other in a physical sense to communicate. So that's great because you can reach a lot of people very quickly, but you can't reach, you know, person to person. But the certain inhibitions disappear when you aren't in the same, you aren't meeting face to face. And people are willing to say things, to make attacks, to act very viciously towards other people on social media, the phenomenon of cyberbullying that they would never dare do if they actually met you in the street, face to face, and so on. So the lifting of that, it can release this really terrible things. And that what goes for interpersonal behavior, the way in which you address another person, also goes for the issue of truthfulness, the issue of ganging up. You could think of all the cases where attack on a certain person spreading through social media have led to actually, in extreme cases, lynching before it could be stopped by any authority that could have got in the way of that act. And you think of the way in which completely untrue statements can be made in great numbers, and this is where social media can be, of course, used, as we see with Putin and others, to create these bots in which people get bombarded with the same accusation or the same claim over and over again, and come to believe that that's the case, but at no point is there a denial of that, a credible denial reaching those people, so they take it as the absolute truth. So I think we need to, and then we're now reacting against that last phenomenon, the problem of truth, but the naivete of Zuckerberg and such people is just incredible, that they don't see that the fact that it's paid advertisement by a political party doesn't get around the fact that it's totally false, and it should never be posted there. They have to be, in other words, the idea of a completely censorship-free medium of communication, immensely positive sides to that you can see, but there's immense negative sides, and more complicated what we can do to cope with this, so I have a few thoughts on that. But it's clear that this is a chain of space, double double-sided phenomenon.
This is not a question for old men. I am not on Facebook. I have never tweeted. I think we may exaggerate the ability, the way in which the new social media enabled you to produce a mass rally, a big crowd. We did that in the 60s with the telephone, leaflets, and newspaper advertisements. We produced very, very big demonstrations. So I'm not sure that it's a great advantage to be able to turn out a lot of people. There are other ways of doing that, and perhaps ways that involve a little more human interaction. We do seem to be accumulating evidence that people act better when they are engaged face-to-face with other people than when they are all by themselves tweeting. I feel myself out of touch with these activities. This is for the next generation. Years ago, I wrote a book called Political Action, a practical guide to movement politics. There's a chapter called The Media. And my idea of what to say about the media was how a movement activist should talk to a journalist. That was my idea of what the media were about. And I'm not much advanced from that position. I continue to believe that the kind of politics we need has to be face-to-face politics. It has to involve people in a union local or a party branch sitting together and talking together. It has to involve knocking on doors and talking to your neighbors. It has to involve making phone calls that are not robocalls. It has to involve those kinds of activities, and if we give up on those kinds of activities, we will experience a democracy deficit.
So you don't believe in one bot, one vote?
But if you could comment on the other part of the question that Charles said a little bit about, the transition from a concern with truth to truthiness, as Stephen Colbert called it, to a post-truth era. This question about, in a way it's a question about the politics of meaning. What's your analysis of that phenomenon and its implications for democratic culture?
It's still important to tell the truth. And we have to, we as citizens have to insist on the importance by punishing people who don't tell the truth. But again, we don't forget that shouting lies or half-truths at mass meetings is one of the oldest forms of politics. If you look at political campaigns in America in the 1830s and 40s, there was a great deal of shouting lies at public meetings.
let's take a couple of questions from the audience. Let's see, Brandon, I talked to you before, so we'll start with you, and then there was we'll get. Tell me your name again.
Kalela.
Yes, from GW. Okay, so right there.
Thank you both for a really fascinating talk. My name is Brandon, but now I'm the chair of the sociology department here. So one thing that struck me as you were speaking is that there seem to be at least two modes of meaningfulness in democratic participation. One is maybe what we can call a deliberative mode, right? So this is pursuing truth and justice, and it entails dialogue and reasoning. The other is a kind of expressive, declarative mode, and this you see this in various expressions whether it's ethnic identity or other kinds of identity that are being asserted. So it's a more assertive mode. It takes offense at any kind of argument that threatens it. And it seems that this kind is simply not open to any reasoning, and this is more conducive to authoritarian nationalism. The first mode seems to require the ability to love truth more than your own opinion. I don't see where we're cultivating capacities for that anymore. I don't think associational life is enough, because associations can, as Putnam showed, they're very good at building, bonding social capital, so within group social capital, but not bridging social capital. So where does that happen? How do we learn to build those capacities to engage with the other, who are people who are very different, and not just ideas, but actual capacities, because it requires dispositions, really be willing to reason and deliberate. You need to love the truth more than your opinion. You have to be oriented in that common direction. So I wonder if you have ideas on what does it take, what are the moral sources, but also the social sources for building those capacities?
I think that loving the truth more than your own opinion, yeah, that sounds very noble, but it maybe doesn't get at all that you need here. The thing is, you and I have, let's say, very different opinions, and we're in a deliberative body. Do I recognize that sometimes you have something important to say that I need to think about in order to correct my views, right? Or do I think about you as this irremediably victim or prisoner of vicious wrong lies? And it's that, it's the first attitude, which is the positive one. It's not, I suppose it entails loving the truth more than your opinion, but it's more specifically linked to who my discussion partners are and what I think about them and so on. How do we get to a point where you have that kind of confidence? And I think we've shattered that. And we've shattered that. What shatters that is people that are determined to prevent one opinion from really appearing at all or having any efficacy at all and so on, where they're willing to, for instance, suppress voting. They're willing to all sorts of game the system in such a way that they don't give a chance to the other side. Mitch McConnell, you want to give me an example from this polity here. And that produces, of course, the counter reaction of the same kind, which is maybe unfortunate but understandable. But how you keep alive the sense that you have something to say to me, even though I disagree with your global position and I mostly think you're wrong, I need you to be there. Get it right in the long run, in all respects.
So I am a critic of deliberation, so let me say a word about that before I respond to the question. Deliberation is what jurors do. Jurors are disinterested men and women, and they argue towards a verdict, which is a true statement. And we would not allow one juror to say to another, I'll vote your way on the first charge if you vote my way on the second charge. That's not what jurors do. That's not deliberation. assembly, that's exactly what happens, and that's what should happen. So argument and compromise are what make up the essence of democratic politics. Now, you were asking deliberation on the one side, self-expression or expressiveness on the other. I think there's a third element of democratic politics that we need to focus on, and that is work, the work of democracy, organizing, talking to other people, mobilizing, agitating, the scut work of a political office, going to meetings. The work of politics is what brings us into close contact with other people, many of whom disagree with us. And it's that work that forces us to think about the other. How do we persuade the other, or how do we coexist with the other? How do we compromise with the other? And my sense of politics in Washington today is that people have given up on that kind of work. And instead, they're obviously not deliberating. We have a dysfunctional Congress. It certainly doesn't deliberate, but it also doesn't bargain. And it is bargaining more than deliberation that I would welcome at this moment.
Thanks. There's a microphone coming around to you.
My name is Tonella. I teach sociology at George Washington University, and I come from South Africa. And I was sitting and wondering, and imagining this conversation in South Africa, and whether it would take the same form. In other words, in a country that is struggling for democracy, as opposed to a country that has got a long established democratic system. And I'm just sharing this as part of that experience, and I'll do it very briefly. It seems to me that the binary between people participating in politics and the kind of Aristotelian and Arendtian is actually not a very helpful one in helping people who are dealing with questions of democracy as a struggle for democracy. In other words, for example, the question of whether people participate or not is not a voluntary process. It's not like people just choose to participate and other people choose to stay out, and you are involved in this rational process of making those choices. What often happens is that people generally don't want to participate. And sometimes we activists don't want everybody to participate. But then what happens is that somebody shoots somebody in a particular community. And so whether they wanted to participate or not, they are brought into the struggle. So there's kind of a dynamism to it, where some people get involved and others get out, but it's an ever-changing situation. I also wanted to say very quickly that seems to me that the distinction between secularization and religion is also would not be helpful. And I mean, on a lighter note, in South Africa you have communists who are Christians, right? We sing the Communist International and we sing the Christian hymns, right? The leaders of the Communist Party are well-known Christians. So sometimes I'm just wondering if some of these well-established binaries can help us situations like that, in those very charged atmospheres.
I'm
going
to give this one to you, Charles.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot there, yeah. I mean, there's a lot there that...
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, a lot there that I agree with, but some of it is very situation-specific. There is a problem of, on one hand, people feel the system, don't have any way of penetrating the system, and so on, particularly in a context in which a lot of things are decided through, you know, paths that we speak of in terms of corruption and so on, you can affect the government. But when extreme attacks occur, then people mobilize. And that's a situation that doesn't, you know, may not offer any alternative to that, but that's not the best condition for democracy. As for the last point you made, yeah, this is something really very, very important to look at, that what are considered to be total binaries in this society or this civilization may have no analog in other societies and other civilizations. I mean, there are civilizations in which what used to be a very powerful binary here, you're either this religion or that religion, just don't apply in the same way. Various parts of India in its history. So we have to be very aware of not making generalizations which are supposed to cover everybody, but which only apply to the local situation.
Okay. Let me take another couple of questions here, and then we'll come back to the audience. Here's a basic one about resilience. Is our democracy resilient enough to tolerate the assaults on it and its norms in our current circumstances? And one way that we can think of the challenges to resilience, I'd like to hear your views on a topic I see rarely addressed in conversations or op-eds or some groups that are too engaged in politics. What about, albeit behind the scenes, what about lobbies or special interests and, I guess, money? So any thoughts that you have about appropriate or inappropriate influences of lobbies, of money, and then this broader question of resilience, the resilience of democracy?
Well, a lot of the history of democratic struggles is a history of bringing numbers to bear against wealth. And that is supposed to work, and often it does. That numbers can defeat an oligarchy. Obviously, we don't want elections to be bought. Elections are one of the things that money shouldn't buy. And there's a long list of things. In a decent society, that money should not be able to buy. It shouldn't be able to buy jury verdicts, and it shouldn't be able to buy political office. On the other hand, I don't believe in the elimination of money from politics. You just have to control the heights. You have to prevent the very wealthy from dominating the political arena. But people like us, one of the ways we express our political commitments is by contributing to a campaign. When I was involved in the anti-war movement in Cambridge, we organized a fair. We had a bake sale. We were offering people a way to show their support by raising money or giving money to a cause. And since we can't expect everyone to exist at the height of political action, there have to be other ways of showing commitment, and that is one way. So I wouldn't defend an entirely state-financed political campaign. I think there is room for money to express commitment. But we have to prevent the very rich from expressing too much commitment and getting their way all the time.
Any thoughts about resilience?
The resilience of a democracy is a function of how you can mobilize people when some really terrible injustices or deprivation is being continued to fight back against it. So in a society, in many of our Western societies, I think we have potential tremendous resilience. I'm thinking of, for instance, the last midterms last year in the United States, when around issues like health care, a lot of people were mobilized to stop, which they didn't really succeed fully in doing, but to stop Obamacare from being totally stripped away. And that was one of the big things that turned people out. That's what resilience amounts to. It's the ability people to get beyond get beyond the sense of just incapacity, but we can't, and to, as it were, organize to such a degree that they can overturn certain political directions that are on that state. So that is the measure of democratic resilience. If ever we get to the point where people feel so alienated, such low citizen efficacy that they can't be ever convinced even to think of mobilizing and turning out, then it's all over.
Okay. Let's take a couple more questions right here, and then we'll go with in the back there. Okay. Asia?
Hello. My name's Gene Hallis. I'm the Vice President of Education for Freedom's Foundation at Valley Forge. My question sort of follows up on the answers that were just given, and that is, we live in a society now in the United States where over the past 20 years we've abandoned civic education. If we're lucky, in all the 50 states, students will read the Constitution, maybe the fifth grade, maybe the eighth grade, sometimes both, and the likelihood of reading it thereafter decreases precipitously, let alone other more basic functional questions of how to be a citizen. So I was wondering if either of you could address that, please.
So we have a constitution that tells us that we may not have an established religion. We don't have. We are barred from establishing religion. And that also means that we are barred, I think, from teaching religion in the public schools. We don't have an established church, but we do have an established state. And it is a democratic state. And therefore, we need to teach democracy in the public schools, for the sake of the established state. It's a feature I've often wondered about, the relationship of religion and ideology in a democracy. In some ways, the ban is similar. A socialist party can win an election and enact its program, but it cannot make its program a catechism in the public schools. And a Christian Democratic Party could enact its program, but it can't make its Christianity a catechism in the public schools. So there is that similarity. But there is also a difference that the secular ideology of democracy we can make a catechism in the public schools, because we have an established democracy, and we don't have a socialist establishment, and we don't have a Christian or Jewish or Muslim establishment. A democratic establishment requires an education for democracy, and that has to go done without a wink and a nod, but seriously, and therefore we have to find ways of testing that it is being done in private and parochial as well as in public schools. I mean, that's a very important democratic activity.
Isn't that nation that is, that state that is established, one nation under God?
So I've heard.
Okay, we had another question in the back there. Did you want to say them? Yeah. Let's see. I think it was you right there. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Hello, Felix Miller, a graduate student in the School of Philosophy here at Catholic University. Thank you both so much. Really enjoyed this. As someone who is more sympathetic to sort of bad populism and less sympathetic to good populism, one thing that I think has been heartening in political discourse in the last 5 or so years has been the movement towards the terminology of the common good, which has often been absent in American political discourse, and both of you appeal to. But I'm wondering sort of what the common good can consist in a liberal democratic framework. Is it just sort of economic benefit and sort of political action, or is there something more robust?
Clearly, it's working out. Now, clearly to me, it's more than, but includes a concern for economic well-being. So I think maybe we best go back to one of the basics, which is 1789 or 1792 or whatever. France, you know, liberty, equality. Fraternity maybe is too gender balanced. Let's say solidarity. I think what we're missing today is the importance of solidarity. That we, you know, we have to help each other. We have to sense that we're all in the same situation together, and that when people really need help, the help can be extended from others that don't need it. Right, and that I think. That concept of the common good is absolutely crucial for our societies. And I think what's happened in Western societies in the last 40, 50 years, and under the influence of various kinds of neoliberalism and so on, the idea that somehow if you let the market do it, everybody will get, is that solidarity has weakened. The development of a high degree of belief in meritocracy among successful minorities, which is always based on illusions. I mean, it's a meritocracy is a belief in which I say, I did it all, it's great, and these other people could have done it just as well, even though they didn't have it. And the meritocratic illusion and neoliberalism, and there's a variety of complex causes for this which we can go into, are eating our society out at the very heart and are making it impossible for us to live and are opening the road to the maddest kind of bad populism.
You talked about the common good too.
Well, there's an easy view of common good. Public health is a common good. Working against climate change is a common good. National security, the physical security of all citizens, this is a common good. But there is something else which is harder and which is what Chuck was just saying in problematic today, and that is the common good of all citizens believing that when they have particular troubles, other citizens will help them. And it's a common good if everyone believes that, but at any given moment, it requires focusing on the good of a particular group of people in trouble. And the achievement of the social democratic welfare state was to create that kind of a common good. Commitment of all the citizens to support some of the citizens some of the time when necessary. And difficult in heterogeneous societies, which is one reason why we have a rather skimpy welfare state, radically incomplete welfare system, as compared with the welfare systems of West European, Central European nation states. And that is a great difficulty for democratic theory, especially for those of us who believe in the value of heterogeneity, of pluralism of ethnicities and religions and races. It may be the case that there is a price for heterogeneity, and the price is a lesser commitment to that version of the common good, which is the common good of particular, that everybody feels that they will be rescued in trouble by everybody else. And in living in an age of increased migrations, we have to think very seriously about how to construct welfare states that in non-homogeneous societies.
Thanks. We have a question here on the aisle and then another one in the front row. Pleased to see Amitai Etzioni here today.
Right there.
Thank you very much, Ryan. And salute my distinguished colleagues. I understand there's a rule that once you reach 91, you can ask your question sitting. So.
That's right.
So, thank you for that. If I had to put my question in one sentence, I would ask if many of the problems we talk about are not problems of liberalism, but problems of capitalism. And so if I imagine, first of all, let me say, obviously, given our current condition, focusing on saving and shoring up the democracy is essential, and I take it for granted, but I'm asking if it's good enough. And so I imagine for a moment that if we would have democracy functioning to perfection, my fellow citizen would ask for more goods and more services. That's what they are taught to believe is a good life. And the question is, if the economies can provide ever more goods for ever more people, or it's time for we need to profoundly change what they consider the good life. Now, we just made one step in that direction by talking about the common good, but beyond that, I'm not talking about those who have not reached their basic needs. Obviously, we need to bring up everybody to a very decent standard of living. But talk about the other, the privileged part, 1% or 50%. If they're going to continue defining the good life as an ever higher standard of living, I don't think the government can deliver. And that's one reason, not the only, but one reason we see riots. Look at Spain for a moment. Spain has a reasonably functioning democracy, but it has 45% unemployment. And it's not because it's not a democratic government. The system is unable to deliver ever more goods to everybody. Now, aside from the fact that it happens to be an environmental and climate problem, so I think what we need to add to democracy and the commissioner and concern for the common good, a profound change of what is a good life.
Very true that we've, and this is one of the ways of seeing the challenge of global warming in these terms, that obviously continued quantitative growth plus continued population growth adds up to more and more strain on certain limits that are just there in the planetary system. And so in the end, we're going to have to think of a conception of the good life that doesn't involve as much transportation of goods and services across large areas using heavy use of energy, and that means that the kind of thing that's being experimented with, for instance, in Holland, building cities where more of what they need can be grown within the city, where people accept certain limits on the use of certain goods or certain modes of energy, And that would mean more fulfillment in ways that don't involve quantitative growth and so on. That's obviously something that's going to be forced on us. And we've got to be creative and far-sighted enough to start experimenting as these Dutch cities are doing. They're experimenting with methods to bring this about. Yeah. So we have this double problem, and this is one of the ways, one of the dilemmas that keep getting posed for us. We have problems of redistribution in the present situation, which would be most easily solved by simply adding to what we now produce and so on, giving the excess. But at the same time, we have this imperative to redefine the good life in the way that you describe. And how you put those two together is a real, real challenge. I mean, I think there are certain important things you can say here, like the proper concept of the Green New Deal is a concept that tries to bring these two together. But yeah, there's a big set of dilemmas here.
Thoughts on revising the good life?
I thought your suggestion was that even if the environment was endlessly available, environmental goods were endlessly available, the life that Western capitalism has produced cannot be sustained.
Should not be.
Hmm?
Should not be.
Should not be, yes. I'm sympathetic to that, but I'm afraid it's not that. The issue is what Chuck just described, that whatever we think about the way of life that capitalism has produced, it is simply unsustainable and unglobalizable, and we are going to face significant changes, and these will be in experience as curtailments of good things that we have enjoyed. And that's the reason, I think, why something like the Green New Deal is the only way to move forward democratically, that we need a politics, and we're very far from this now, but we need a politics that will guarantee to people in industries that are being discontinued, industries that are no longer possible, like the coal industry. We need a form of politics that tells those people that whatever sacrifices they are making will be shared. There will be some equality of sacrifice across the community and equality of effort to minimize the hurt that is imposed on particular groups of people. That's why I was recently at a conference with the title, Is Social Democracy Dead? And my response was, it can't be dead because it's necessary. This is the politics that will enable us democratically, the only politics that will enable us democratically to deal with the climate crisis.
Okay. Here in the front row, Professor Irvine.
This is Irovani, has been working at Catholic University for the last 20 years, and Father McLean was the main cause for me to be here and teaching courses and so on. So thank you very much for your wonderful inputs. First of all, the topic was about the meaningfulness of the democracy. Still I'm in search of understanding, and I really appreciate if both of you can elaborate a little bit more about the meaningfulness of democracy, how and in which way we can give more meaning to that. I learned a few words. I know the time was short, like the solidarity or education or spirituality, but if there is anything else, I'd really appreciate if you can give give us more elaboration on that. Now, we are hearing the, and there are some attributions like Christian's democracy or Islamic democracy or Jewish democracy. What are your inputs on that? To what extent religion can play in a positive way towards democracy? As we know, and you know better than me, that there are not always agreement between the democratic demands of majority and between what religious leaders or authorities are asking for. Mainly, they are claiming that these are revelations, and then what we have is beyond your intellect or beyond your demand. And in this society that we are living, although there is a separation of church and state, but no one can deny the role of religion in politics, especially these days. If you look at President Trump's supporters in the terms of the people who voted or supporting him, there are a mainstream of evangelists and others who are supporting him for the values they believe these are the values they must fulfill it. So to what extent, in positive way, religion can contribute towards a better and moral and spiritual life.
Very good. We're going to run over just a little bit, so we'll take this question, and then we'll gather a couple of last questions, okay?
Well, there's a lot in your question. I don't know where to start. But maybe we can start here, that Christian democracy, Islamic democracy, conceivably even Jewish democracy, the last minute, can be read in very different ways. Now, the actual fact is that Christian democracy has largely arisen, I mean, the party's calling themselves that, in opposition to a very narrowly construed conception of Catholicism or Protestantism, which would dictate the terms of the entire society. Yeah. But the problem is that in the Islamic world, Islamism, like the Muslim Brothers, are putting forward a notion that Islam, in some sense, has answers to all these questions, as against a more realistic view, which is that inspired by the Quran, you can try to find various solutions, but the solutions are to be found in the particular situation in which we find ourselves. Now, the battle is going on now in the Islamic world, because people think like that, and people think that Sharia is something that gives all the answers today. And I think you can understand what the motivation is for that wrong view, which is a sense of being threatened by colonialism or whatever, etc. But it's only at the moment when all religions have the humility to understand that they can't just take their sacred scriptures and pick the answers out for all the problems that they face, that we can have a real democracy with religious input. Yeah.
There is a story in the Talmud of a group of rabbis who were judges, and they were arguing a case of some ritual issue. And a majority came down on one side, and there was a minority, I think, of one person who disagreed. And he called upon God to support his position. And the walls of the courtroom shook in response to this one rabbi's petition. And the other rabbis said, doesn't matter, it is not in heaven. And they insisted that the majority of the rabbis, the decision of the majority, should prevail. The phrase is, it is not in heaven, comes from the book of Deuteronomy. This is a use of it on not biblical, but rabbinic. It is not in heaven. We, the majority, will decide. And I think a lot of issues have to be, it has to be said about a lot of issues that they are not in heaven. They are for us to decide, and existence of different religions in a democratic society requires some agreement on those issues that are not in heaven.
Okay, we're going to go to the lightning round here and collect some questions together. Pascal, did you have a question in back? Yeah? Okay. All the way back, we'll take Phil. We have a right here in the front row, and we'll have a couple more here on the side. All right, then we'll have to wrap things up, I think.
Thank you for the presentation. I'm grateful. I will try to speak in a good English so you'll understand. My question is linked to education of the voter and democracy. Because I come from, I'm from Chad. My name is Mutanga Bayo Chantal, work for Ogate and student at Catholic University. From Chad, we have this kind of democracy that came after colonization, dictatorship, and democracy in 1990. Then I came here in the United States and I met a woman in 2015, November. We are talking about democracy and watching the movement. And she said that candidate will not win. And I say no, he will win. Because from what I hear, he will be the president. She looked at me and she said, you don't know how democracy, you are new in American democracy, so go and learn. I said, okay. But I expressed that to her because I want her to not have a heart attack when the election, the result will come out. And finally, he won. They considered me at that time in 2015 like someone that knew nothing about American democracy. I was not believing in democracy in Chad for the reason that is clear, we know the result before the election. And I came here and I was not listening and I realized that it's the kind of same way. I don't know, maybe I'm different, but I understood that something is going on, like it's subtle, the result. So how to explain to people in Africa that has no education to understand the subtlety or to react and be able to fight for the real liberty. Because there is a kind of tool that people use in democracy to be able to win election. Not because they are trying to provide liberty or real democracy, but a kind of ideology that is clear to them or proper to them. It's not really linked to population, not really linked to human beings sometimes. So how to explain to that population, educated or not, to understand that subtlety? Thank you.
Okay. Phil, right here. Let's try to keep our questions at this point as short as we can.
My question is about leadership, and I would be very interested in hearing both from Charles and Michael. What are some of the qualities of political leadership that are needed in the situation democracy currently finds itself? I'm not asking for a portrait of a philosopher. But some of the qualities that would make it possible for democracy to effectively be nurtured and function.
Okay. Next, we have right here in the second. Actually, we'll have to get you both very quickly.
Hi, my question is inspired by the interest in social media. And while we may not all Facebook, we may not all tweet, our technology is following us everywhere. And what we are discovering is that there's an erosion of our private lives. We're known by certain institutions, everything is known. Is there a danger pushback protecting our right to privacy, and do you see any ramifications, even though the old ways of culture are eroding, I mean, you know, waving to a new way where everything is known, algorithms are being, you know, calculated by the pictures I took of you.
My name is Dalal Alexander, and my question is, I hear it and I from different sources that they say, well, the United States is not really a democracy, it is not a republic, it is actually an oligarchy. And all this process of voting and all this is just an illusion of choice. And if it is really an oligarchy, so all we're doing are we just voting to elect one oligarchy versus another oligarchy, and it's not really for the good of people.
Okay, thank you. You want to?
Sure.
Go ahead, John.
This is mainly for Professor Taylor. You've written of the post-revolutionary mindset of this the secular age, especially in relation to religion, which is seen as in the past. How do you think that religious people like us can respond to secularists who are increasingly seeming to challenge or oppress religious ways of living so that they can acknowledge our religious freedom?
Okay, and finally we had a couple here on the end. Jose.
My question is about the tension between national democracy, the fact that democracy functions within the nation state, and the most serious problems we are facing today, the challenges with the ecological global crisis, whether the global capitalism, whether global migrations. Those are challenges that cannot be, they have to be addressed by our democracy, but cannot be solved, or they cannot be really. And part of the crisis comes precisely from this awareness. We see the crisis in the European Union and the attempt of these populist movements to regain national sovereignty. When even the most powerful country in the world claims that we are being taken by everybody, and we need to regain, to make America great again, we need to regain national sovereignty. So there is, on the one hand, a notion that we have to go back to the old national sovereign democracy, precisely the moment in which the problems are increasing global. So this is one of the fundamental, because obviously every crisis is national, but the fact that this crisis happened today everywhere in the globe simultaneously means we are facing a new global reality. And the question is, can we simply solve those problems by making, or can we improve our democracy in a way that go beyond the nation state? Can we think, do we need to think institutionally, creatively, of ways of addressing those problems that are transnational?
Okay. And Phoenix?
Sam,
sorry, Sam.
So I'm Sam Kimberly, political philosopher as well. So one theme that I hear very frequently, maybe especially in DC, is that we have structural problems that are creating the crisis we're in, and they should be fixed structurally. It strikes me that you could tell the same story, say, the last decade, a quite different way, which is that society is much more like an organism that has been wounded in a certain way, and there's a sense of political trauma that has been working its way out. And if that's correct, the question of how you would, it's in other words, we have, our problems are arising not from too little sensitivity, but actually from an excess of sensitivity. Like we feel things very deeply as a people. And so the question of how you have that human dimension as central to our debate about how you would address political crises seems like something that's essential and also very, very difficult to introduce into a system that, a situation that is perpetually thinking in systems. So interesting.
Okay, thank you all very much. I'll briefly enumerate the laundry list of options that we have, and you can pick and choose which of those you'd like to respond to. So we had a question about the human dimension of crises in democracy. A question about whether democracy can move beyond national sovereignty, I think, and find new institutions that don't rely so much on some institutions of the nation. a question about religious members in a democracy and their liberty in response to secularism or secularists. We had a question about whether democracy is simply becoming oligarchy today. That had something to do, too, I think, with Chantal's question, how is democracy here really different from democracy in a place like Chad, where the elections are foregone conclusions? One more question about qualities of leadership for democratic leaders. And finally, a question that I would say also has to do with the issue of surveillance, of how much privacy and how much surveillance can a democratic society put up with. So there you have a long laundry list of things. Let me ask you to respond to whichever of those you can.
Maybe I won't quite get to all of them, but let me start with the one that Jose was raising. I think that the big issue is how fast can you get across to people in any given society that they're going to be cooked too, right? That they can't escape this. They can't escape some of these terrible consequences. And I'm very worried by the fact that, for instance, we in, let's say, North America and the West Coast of both societies are seeing these huge fires, right? And I can enumerate a whole lot of other cases, still hasn't somehow penetrated to a lot of people's minds. But the thing is that it's no longer just a matter of saying to people it's more just, it's more universal, it's more human, it's nicer to think of the whole planet rather than to think of just the United States. But I'm sorry, that's also true, but it's true that New York is going to be under several meters of water, and it can go on and on and on. And how fast we can get that through. I'm a little bit disturbed because, as I said earlier, that somehow the fact that your president can actually say and not seem to lose immediately all credibility, it doesn't exist. In Canada, we're just one notch better. The Canadian Conservative leader didn't dare say it's a false problem. He said you have to do something about it. Not this, not that, not that, not that, not that. So hypocrisy, even the hypocrisy, what did Dao Shu Gu say? Hypocrisy is the homage that vice pays to virtue. And maybe that's already a step along the road, but it's not far enough. How to get that kind of thing happening? Well, the thing is that we have a good talking point. The question is, I don't quite know how to make people really feel that. And I think I can understand people turning off because it looks like such a huge problem. And maybe what we need is not only better programs, but more diffusion of these programs. Because when you look at the series of programs that you can undertake, which are include more than finding non-carbon energy sources, they include that, planting trees, et cetera, the thing could be the object of a great deal of enthusiasm. We can, really do this. Wir schaffen es, as Angela Merkel said. But in this case, it has to. It could take off. And can I just go to Phil's question of good leadership? I mean, certainly you need what people call charisma. Very hard to define exactly. But I mean, that people who are really able to get across their program and enthuse people with their program. But you need to have that go together with one other very important quality, and they rarely do, and that is the quality of being able to listen and grasp what people are about, including people who are totally against, including people that are saying things that are quite horrifying to you, exclusionary doctrines of citizenship and so on, to get a sense of the multiple motivations behind this and be able to talk to at least some of them in
think about the people who follow the leader. On many parts of the liberal left today, there is a greater version to leadership. If you were to attend one of the general assemblies at Occupy Wall Street or any other of the occupiers, you would find an absolute refusal to recognize that there should be or could be leaders. So there can't be leaders unless there are followers, people willing to not only what you have to hold the leader accountable, but there has to be leadership in any organization if the organization is going to be effective. I remember an SDS community project back in the 60s when the belief was that you had to have community people running the meeting, but the community people were not the leaders. And so the SDS organizer who sat in the back, and everybody got a crook in their necks looking for cues from the guy in the back. But the official position was that the community people up front were running the meeting. You need people who can run meetings. You need people who can talk in public. You need people who can inspire others to work harder than they usually do. And those kind of people need to be recognized. And then they also need to be held accountable. I want to say something about the nation state. I am a statist, as some of you may know. I think the people who are worse off in the world today are people who don't have a state, like Kurds, Palestinians, Tibetans, or people who are living in failed states, as many parts of Africa. There's vast human suffering, which can only be relieved by an effective nation state. The nation, the state remains the crucial agents of collective action in the world today. And the road to environmental justice and environmental life runs through the nation state, as we can see in the United States today, where only a determined political majority can get the U.S. back into the Paris Agreement and back into any effective role. In every advance in climate control is going to come through battles in nation states. That's still where political action is possible, and state action is the crucial form of action in the world today. So I am not I'm not high on transcending the nation state. I recognize that mass migration poses great problems to the existence of and the democratic potential of nation states. But that's something we're going to have to figure out, and the politics of figuring it out is going to take place inside nation states. There is no alternative at this moment. The international society does not yet provide political space for militant for organization. It doesn't. The space for politics is still the space provided by the nation.
Thank you. I think we're just getting to the really meaty topics here about democracy, but we're out of time for today. So I thank all of you for coming. We will look for ways to continue this discussion. My apologies to anyone whose questions we didn't get to attend to. And let's give our speakers one more warm round of applause.